Welcome to Walk in Truth Christian Fellowship Church, where faith meets community. Our fantastic Bible study sessions are more than just learning. They're a journey of faith and enlightenment. We engage with the scriptures in a profound way, connecting with people across the globe through our dynamic outreach programs. Our teaching and preaching inspire transformation, reaching hearts from all corners of the world. Whether you're joining us in person or online, you'll find a warm, inclusive environment. Join us at Walk in Truth Christian Fellowship Church, where your journey of faith is supported every step of the way. Together, let's walk in truth.
Thank you for tuning into the Walk in Truth Radio Network broadcast. Grab your Bible, get settled, and let's walk through the Word of God together. Let us now reason together and listen to see what God is saying to us today.
Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, I just thank you. I thank you for your Word. I thank you for your people. Continue to bless us as we begin to continue to study out the seven dispensations plus one and give us a better understanding of how the Bible is rightly divided. Okay, last time we talked about innocence. And can anybody give me in their own words what the period of innocence in this dispensation represented as far as man relationship to God? What was the period of innocence represent? Anybody?
Before sin?
Before
Adam and Eve sinned in this world.
Okay, before.
Innocence in the garden.
Okay. Speak up, please. I mean, you're right, but speak up so we can record it.
With Adam and Eve, before they were sinned, they tricked.
Okay. Okay. What was that relationship like with God?
Pure, direct,
personal.
Pure, direct, personal.
Unashamed.
What's the difference between what ruled what in the innocence phase?
The spirit ruled the flesh.
Yes. And then when they fell, it switched, right? Everything became upside down. Okay. So we know the period of innocence is what we will experience again in the millennial kingdom. Okay, so when you hear people that song say going back to Eden, it's if you look at it just in a sense of that time of pure innocence, we'll experience that in the millennial kingdom, but we got to get there. Okay, and that's what we're working towards in the dispensations. The last true dispensation is the millennial kingdom. Like I said, I gave you a bonus dispensation to explain, because the dispensation theology, There's people who divide them up in subdivisions within this seven. Yeah. So you can have 21, you can have 41, depending on how you want to divide it up for yourself. And this is a tool for us, okay? So we can learn to rightly divide the word of truth. So right now, you should know the difference between Israel, Judah, Israel the nation, Israel the northern kingdom, Judah the southern kingdom, and the body of Christ. You should know when you read your Bible, what he talking about? Okay, it ain't all melded together. So this is another way to think about rightly dividing the word of truth. And the first five dispensations are all in the Old Testament. All of them. All the first five are in the Old Testament. And so if you ever think about it, just the first five is the Old Testament. Okay, so we're going to get started in conscience. And you guys did good with innocence. Okay. All right, Steve, let's go.
The dispensation of conscience, introduction. The dispensation of conscience occurs following the dispensation of innocence, which ended with Adam and Eve's act of disobedience. After sin entered the human experience, they gained the knowledge of good and evil, altering humanity's state from one of innocence to one of moral awareness and responsibility.
So when they became conscious, they became conscious of good and evil. And the way the Bible illustrated their conscience was, what did he say? After they fall, what happened? They knew they were.
They knew they were naked.
They knew they were naked. That was the morality to which they thought. And God said, who told you you was naked? Okay? So their eyes became open. They didn't become like gods. They became like flesh. The devil tricked them. A spiritual transition where the flesh rules the spirit now, okay? So their consciousness depends on what they see, the five senses. It rules, something from the outside rules their determination and how they're going to relate to each other, okay? They've lost the pure spiritual connection. So God is dealing with them externally and allowing them to experience this thing called evil, all right? All right, Steve, go ahead.
Duration. This period stretches from the fall in the Garden of Eden to the time of Noah, encapsulated in Genesis 3:8 through Genesis 8:22. Mm-hmm. Key events. 1. Moral awareness. When Adam and Eve were banished from Eden, humanity took on the responsibility to navigate life with an awareness of good and evil, guided by the conscience. 2. The story of Cain and Abel. This narrative highlights early human struggles in making moral choices. Cain, subsequently, succumbing to jealousy, kills his brother Abel, illustrating the flawed nature of human conscience.
So we see murder coming to the framework of the human experience through jealousy. So my question is, what was he jealous of? Who said relationship? Who said relationship? Ava. Say it again, Ava.
The relationship.
Of who? I hope you get this part right. Of who? Go ahead. Who's the relationship with?
Abel and God.
There you go. Right. Thank right. He was jealous of the relationship God had with them. Now, in the earlier class, we defined the differences, even though we put them together. There is a difference between jealousy and envy. Okay, jealousy is, I'm jealous of you because you have a relationship with her. Okay, he was jealous of the relationship. So jealousy normally comes in a three package. Okay, yeah. I'm jealous of something that you have in relationship to something else. Envy says, I want what you have.
Yeah.
He didn't necessarily want what he had. He just was jealous of it, of the relationship that Abel had with God, because we know Abel brought a more accepted sacrifice. It's not that Cain could not. Cain decided not to. Okay? Because even God say, hey, you can go, you can get a redo. Just go get, ask your brother, swap out and bring their offering. But again, be careful, because when you move in jealousy, you can end up in murder. Mm-hmm. How many lifetime stories are there? Every lifetime story is about jealousy.
Yes, yes.
Every lifetime story is about jealousy. Yeah. I'm so sick of lifetime. I'm like, every lifetime story is about somebody being jealous about somebody else.
And it's based on true stories.
So we see how powerful the sin of jealousy is on mankind. All right? Mm. All right, Stacy, pick up.
Pervasive wickedness and corruption.
Humans got a key.
That's Nancy.
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead.
Human society began to spiral into greater moral corruption as evil actions became widespread. Genesis 6:5. God's heart was grieved by the state of humanity, necessitating profound intervention. The conclusion. The dispensation of conscience culminates with the great flood, through which God judges the earth for its rampant wickedness. Only Noah and his family found favor with God, preserving the hope for humankind and transitioning to the next dispensation. Genesis 6:8-9.
Okay, somebody get Genesis 6:8-9. Just read it. Whoever get it first.
Six, eight, and nine.
Mm-hmm.
The
it says, but Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. There are generations of Noah. Noah was a righteous man, blameless in his generation. Noah walked with God.
Mm-hmm. So how many people got saved on the ark?
Eight.
Okay. And you said Noah found favor with God. What's another word for favor?
Peace.
Nope.
Grace.
Grace. Who said that? Marion got it right. Grace. Isn't the word, don't we describe the favor of God, grace?
Yes.
Okay, so Noah received the grace of God, and God said he was an upright man. Okay? Now, I don't want you to think that Noah was sinless.
No.
He was just, he got grace, and if God gives you grace, it almost assumes that he's considering you for an assignment. He considered Noah, and Noah was obedient to what he was assigned to do. Build this, and he had, what, over 100 years to build this ark and tell people and warn people about the impending doom and forgive, and God gave them a chance to repent and change, but they did not do so. So God moved forward his program. But the one thing we see is grace, and also we Noah received, what's the other word we know we received?
Mercy.
Grace and mercy always together. So anytime you see grace, you can always throw mercy in there. He gave him mercy too. He saved 8 people to carry on a promise. Now, I'm going to go back. In the Garden of Eden, after the fall, what was promised that's good that he gave Eve? What did he tell Eve? That one day what going to happen?
Your seed going to crush the head of the serpent.
And what's the other part?
Humanity.
And the other part, you got the good, you got the one part, and whoever bruises Satan's head is going to bruise the heel, okay? So we see the beginning of the coming who? Of Jesus, the coming Messiah. Okay, so if he wiped out everybody, we know that couldn't happen. So we have God keeping his promise with the 8 that's going to repopulate the world. Okay, he's going to repopulate the world with the 8. All right, go ahead, Stacey.
Relevant scripture, Genesis 3:8-24, chronicles the expulsion from Eden and the onset of moral consciousness. Genesis 6:5-7 reflects God's observation of moral degradation and the decision to cleanse the earth. References for further study.
Don't worry about the books. You don't have to go to the books. So get Genesis 6:5-7, Venus.
6:5-7. Mm-hmm. The Lord saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of thoughts of his heart was only evil continuously. And the Lord regretted that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart. So the Lord said, I will blot out the man whom I created from the face of the land, man, animals, and creeping things, and birds of heavens, for I am sorry that I have made them.
So we see God grieving over his creation that what? Turned his back on him. So that means you can see God, you can see then when we talk about grieving the Holy Spirit, we have the first grievance with God then. Well, God had waited after Adam for a long time, but man kept getting pervasively, which means it kept going worse and worse and worse, pervasively wicked, okay? And it grieved God that he even made man, okay? Because God did not want man to turn from him, you know? And God always grieves when his creation, which is humankind, turns away from him. But our consciousness is so ruled by our 5 senses that it's hard for us to understand how to move our conscience into a position where our conscience is a God conscious. And when we come to Christ, that's what you get when you get the Holy Spirit. You get now not just a consciousness of your flesh and evil, you get a consciousness of what is good in Christ. And your goal is to strengthen your conscience of God that's in you and diminish the control of the conscience of your flesh. That takes time, and that takes the word, and that takes prayer. That takes work. That's called the sanctification process. You don't do this to get saved. You do this once you are saved so you can mature into the fullness of God. Okay? All right. Go ahead, Stacy. Go to the next part.
Thought-provoking question.
And
we reflect on the dispensation of conscience where mankind was guided by their internal moral compass, we might ask ourselves, in our complex modern world, how much do we still rely on conscience alone to make moral decisions? And what external influences shape our understanding of right and wrong today?
Okay. How much do we rely on consciences now, today, with your saved self, to make moral decisions? Floor is open.
Too much.
I mean, give me some examples if you want to share.
Every decision that we make, we use our conscience, mm-hmm. whether it's good or bad.
Mm-hmm.
But it depends on what's good and bad.
Right, and if your conscience is shaped with the biblical view, then you should be okay.
But you're not going to, you got preconceived notions from what your family taught you, from what mixed ideologies that the churches that you went to. So your concept of what good and bad is muddled. Mm-hmm. It's not pure. I think the only people, and I honestly truly believe, can really determine what's good or bad are kids under five. Because this hurts, so I'm going to do this. Their good or bad is determined by the people who are around them. Good and bad is subjective. Because some people might say, well, if somebody hit me, I hit them back, or shoot them back. That might be good. That consciousness is debatable.
Okay. Anybody else?
But he says also that he puts that into our hearts. He puts his spirit in our hearts. So we know what good and bad is. Now, whether we live that way or not,
okay.
That's a choice.
Right. And read the first question again, Stacy. The first part of the question.
As we reflect on the dispensation of conscience where mankind was guided by their internal moral compass, we might ask ourselves, in our complex modern world, how much do we still rely on conscience alone to make moral decisions?
And because of what Venus says, which she's talking about postmodern relativism.
Yeah.
Okay, meaning that what has happened to us in this world is this new thing people say, which is just postmodern relativism, is that everybody got a truth. And truth is subjective to the person and my experiences. So we're having a relationship with God based upon me, not based upon the word. Okay, so what everybody, if I gave a certain scenario, just with our political election, that's old postmodern relativism, because everybody said everybody else was demonized. Okay, if you didn't vote this way or you didn't vote that way, you were demonized. I'm right, you wrong. I'm God, you not. That's postmodern relativism, because what you're doing is not taking the word of God. You're setting up your own kingdom in your own mind to subject yourself to it. So we go back to the Old Testament, and where in the Old Testament does it say that relativism kicked in?
Judges.
Where it said what?
I do whatever I want to, whatever makes me feel right.
What I do was right in my own eyes. That's relative righteousness. And religion teaches relative righteousness, because religion is denominational, and every denomination believes that the denomination is going to heaven and everybody else going to hell. Okay? So this relativism plays a big role in our lives today.
Considering that what was moral 10 years ago is not moral now.
That's right.
If you're going to abide by the law, mm-hmm. there's a lot of laws that are passed that don't align with
yeah.
biblical values.
Yeah. Yeah. So we're ruled by mob truth.
Correct.
Whoever is the majority gets to set the standard.
Mm-hmm. Which should not be.
Which should not be, but that's the world we live in. And as Christians, we need to rise above that, mm-hmm. so we can operate knowing that we can get sucked up into the moral, postmodern subjective reality of truth versus objective truth. Our truth is based upon the object of Christ and his word, period. It stands alone. But we know in America, it changes. Like Nancy said, the laws change, everything changed up and down. What was popular 20 years ago and not moral today, it's going to always change. Culture is not a good barometer to which determine what is true, what is good, and what is holy. But you have to fight against that. Because our natural mind, as Kevin said, we do it all the time. Like I said, the election proved you do it all the time. I laughed. Because, see, Daniel chapter, what, Venus, 4:7? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was the end of discussion for me. Did y'all ever read that for real? Not other than you. Okay. All right. I know. Okay, let's read it again. Somebody get Daniel 4. Matter of fact, let's get it out of the easy read version. Let's get it out of like the NIV or the CEB or one of those paraphrases. Whatever, which you going to give me?
I mean,
which one you want to give me?
NIV.
Give me the NLT and the NIV.
I got the NIV, Daniel 4, what?
7. You do the NLT, Venice. Go ahead.
Daniel 4:7 from the NIV. When the magicians, enchanters, astrologers, and diviners came, I told them the dream.
But no, that's not it.
It's not 4:7.
It's 5, 6, and 7.
No, it's in 3.
I thought it was in 4:17.
I thought it was in 3.
You thought it was in 3?
Uh-huh, we said it in 3.
Okay.
Because we read it on Sunday.
Okay, I know.
But it was in 3.
Is it Daniel 3:10, your majesty has issued a decree?
No.
It's
4:17. 4:17,
okay. We mentioned both of them.
Okay, give 4:17, Frida.
Okay.
Daniel 4:17, and this should settle the issue. Go ahead.
From the NIV, the decision is announced by messengers. The holy ones declare the verdict, so that the living may know that the Most High.
Who?
That the Most High.
No, James Hutton.
No, the Most High.
The Republican Party.
The Most High.
The Democratic Party.
The Most High.
Got to be the Green Party. The Most High, right?
Yes.
All right, go ahead. I just want to make sure we know what we're talking about. Go ahead. What did he decide?
The Most High is sovereign over all kingdoms on earth and gives them to anyone he wishes and sets over them the lowliest of people.
So in other words, anybody that's in office is not considered the greatest. They're considered the lowliest. You know why the person is there that you hate? It's to drive you to God.
There it is.
If you don't like them, it's supposed to drive you to God. If you didn't like Kamala, if she got elected, it should have drove you to God. Yeah. That's why they there. Okay, what does the NLT say? Venus.
I don't have the NLT, but I have the ASV, and it says the sentence mm-hmm. is by the decree of the watchers
mm-hmm.
and the demand by the word of the holy ones to the intent that the living may know that the Most High ruleth in the kingdom of men and give it to whosoever he will and sit up over it the lowest of men.
So in other words, why we worried about who getting elected, we just better learn that the sovereign God made that decision. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And he made that decision against what you want to drive you to him. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. That's all. And if you got what you want, it's still supposed to drive you to him. Okay, so now that I know this, I don't sweat at all about nobody. I don't, you know, because there's no reason to.
But that's a little bit, I agree, and I'm not disagreeing. But it's complex when you have to deal in everyday situations with worldly people and worldly concepts.
Well, that's the conscience that we're talking about.
Right.
Yeah, it's difficult. I ain't gonna never say, I'm beyond saying stuff is difficult. That's just life. Everything is difficult in this flesh. But I gotta go with God say, regardless if it's difficult. God don't care about me it being difficult to me. God say, either you gonna follow what, if you gonna trust what I say, or you not. No matter what the nuance is. Okay? And you got to grow into that. It don't happen overnight. Okay? It ain't gonna happen because you just read it. You gotta rest in it. You know, there's some people that stayed up all night long. I mean, they couldn't leave. They were scared to leave the television. Next day, people crying and they snorting and they talking about, hold up, today they talking about leaving America? Boy, where you gonna really go? For real. A person that's talking about leaving America obviously never lived abroad. Kevin say, right. That's a military man. He say, do you really want to live abroad? Have you ever watched a series because show Locked Up Abroad? That show ain't no joke.
Yeah, because the queen will put you to death to steal.
Yeah, so we have to understand that we have to mature into trusting God's word about stuff. And God really don't care about our nuance. Because our nuance is part of that conscious of flesh. I could think of any reason to go against what God say. And it'll sound good. And most of us, we can think of nuances that we can bring into the equation and say, hey, this, that. And God say, so that ain't what I said. Okay, either you're going to trust me or you not. And the difficulty is not with what I said. The difficulty is what you believe. Okay, and that's where the relativism comes in. That's where the subjectiveness comes in. It's a mature thing. And again, I'm just going to keep saying that because it's not like, oh, I got all of it and understand it. I just made it so simple because I'm a simpleton. It's like, look, either God said it and I can understand the simple language of this sentence and I have to trust God. Yeah, I can't. It's not like a deep thing. He said, I put in office and I put the lowliest of men. I'm done. Okay. And whatever good they do, great. But everything supposed to run me to God. Don't you think God created pain for you to run to him? Mm-hmm. Of any kind? Okay? Everything's supposed to lead us to the Savior. Because he's the only one that can lead us. I can't wait till I can't wait till we end the millennium. Because the millennium kingdom, no pain. No problems. Everybody love each other. We don't even know what that would look like. No more stealing, no more robbing, no more pain, no more death. We couldn't even handle it in the presence that we are in now. That's why we have to get a glorified body to handle all the good of God. Amen. All right, Frieda, pick up the next question. It's the second part of this next question. First question.
What external influences shape our understanding of right and wrong today?
That's what we answered. Okay. All right. Go to the next. All right. Go ahead to the next thing.
Dispensation of government.
Mm-hmm.
The dispensation of government is a significant theological concept that refers to a specific period in biblical history where God entrusted humanity with the responsibility of self-governance under his divine principles. This period follows the Great Flood and is characterized by God's establishment of human authority to maintain societal order and justice on earth.
Mm-hmm.
It reflects a shift from a direct divine rule experienced in earlier dispensations to a delegated authority framework where humans are given broader responsibility.
So the human now is given broader responsibility, that relationship has been severed, and you're heading towards, you're going to rule yourself. I'm going to let you rule yourself. You don't want me, I'm going to let you rule yourself. I'm going to give you the responsibility of governing yourself. Okay? Go ahead.
This dispensation begins with the renewal of God's covenant with Noah after the flood, as recorded in Genesis 8:20 through 9:17. Upon leaving the ark, Noah builds an altar and offers sacrifices to God. In response, God blesses Noah and his descendants, instructing them to be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth, Genesis 9:1. Key to this period is the establishment of human authority and the mandate for justice, as seen in Genesis 9:6. Whoever sheds human blood, by humans shall their blood be shed, for in the image of God has God made mankind.
So God now introduces what we call capital punishment. If you murder, you will lose your life. Now, he didn't do that. He didn't do that to Cain, did he?
No.
He gave Cain grace. But he now introduces capital punishment. Capital punishment say, again, you take a life, you give your life in exchange for a life. And God gave the reason why he gave this. He said, because all men are created in my image. Okay? All men are created in my image. Matter of fact, somewhere in the Bible says, out of one man, he made all races. He made all the races out of one man. Okay? So what we have to do is get out of our ethnicity, get out of our position, and understand that when God lays down something, right now, it's for all generations to come. So he says now, the penalty for taking another human's life who's made in my image is you give up your life. Okay? You give up your life. All right, Frieda, go ahead.
This scripture emphasizes the responsibility placed on humanity to adjudicate justice and uphold societal order.
Okay, Venus, what does adjudicate mean?
To proceed with the trial, to proceed with the charges, okay. To try it.
Mm-hmm. So man is in a position to judge their behavior, okay? This government, you're there to judge your behavior. You decide if it's right or wrong, all right? But we know we already in the period where our consciousness is getting seared, so we can imagine how this ends up. Watch happen. Go ahead. Freedom.
Educate justice and uphold societal order, marking the beginning of structured governance.
Mm-hmm.
End of the dispensation. The dispensation of government culminates in the incident of the Tower of Babel, outlined in Genesis 11, 1 through 9. Here, humanity unites to build a city and a tower to make a name for themselves, directly contravening God's command to fill the earth.
Mm-hmm.
In response, God confounds their language, causing them to be scattered across the globe, thereby nullifying their efforts to centralize power and control.
So God left them to do something, and the first thing they did, they wanted to build a city, and they wanted to build a tower. Mm-hmm. Why do you think they wanted to build a tower?
They wanted to reach heaven.
And why do you think they wanted to reach heaven? Because they wanted to be like who?
God.
They wanted to be like God. Where do we see that? Who's the first beginner of that one? Satan. He posed that question to Adam and Eve. He said, the day you eat of this, you'll become like God. So we see when man governs himself by his seared conscience that he's naturally going to want to be his own God. And the first thing he builds is a church. The first thing he builds is a building, an idol, a structure, brick and mortar. I'm going to build a tower to show that I'm either worthy or I want to be like God. So man's imagination began to kick in. And we see that all around the other world now. Men's imagination built these churches. For good, and I'm not worried about the good or bad part. What I'm saying to you is these are monuments, and we think these monuments have a holy aura in them. But that's just the same thing as the Tower of Babel. Men could have one language, and God say, They're trying to proceed to me through their flesh. Building a city, building a tower is a flesh thing. They're not trying to have a relationship with me. They're trying to have a relationship to get to me so they can overthrow me possibly or whatever. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to scatter them all over the earth and give everybody a different language. Okay. So with this, we see that these different languages, then we see the tower not have its effect on the people, but God had to take a drastic measure. Now, what God could have done is destroy them. But you have to remember, his original promise can't happen unless somebody live. And he didn't want to go back through that, right? So he let these people live. He just scattered them. Where else do we see, now in the future, where else do we see a scattering? I can't hear you, Nancy. Speak up.
The captivity of Syria, when they scattered everybody, the Israelites.
Mm-hmm. And there's a whole bunch of times they got scattered, right?
Mm-hmm. After Jesus' halftime, yeah. Jesus' death after mm-hmm. the cross that got scattered because of the persecution of the church.
Mm-hmm. So Jesus prophesied that the idol of their temple was going to come down. And in 70 AD, Caesar brought it down and destroyed Jerusalem again. And the Bible says to this day, they have been scattered throughout the world. They're not lost. That's one of the misnomers that people say that don't make sense. If God scattered them, guess what also God do? He know where they at. See, that's good talk when you're talking to people who are don't know, to just listen to people who say stuff. The lost, the 12, the 10 lost tribes of Israel. They not lost. God know exactly where he the one who scattered them. He know exactly where they at. You don't know where they at. And neither should you care. Because you're not Israel. You the body of Christ. See, it's real simple for me. You know, to know what tribe I come from, what difference does it make? You know, and then we were talking about today. It was interesting today. We were talking about some people say in the community, you know, we need to have our own languages. Okay. And what I did was show them how to use their supercomputer called the phone and Google and say, how many languages in particular, Steve, is in Africa? Do you know how many they said? Guess. Give me a number.
Over 1,000.
Over 1,000. Give me. So it's over 1,000. How many do you think? 3,000 or more. So which language should we have? Pick out of 3,000. Which, see, this is the thing. You start taking pride in things that's not of God. Because of your seared conscience and your pride, all right? They had pride and was going to build. And so we see all of the, we see the lust of the flesh. We see the lust of the eye building a temple. And we see the pride of life. We see all of that in the building of the Tower of Babel. And that's why we call, when somebody talks in gibberish, we call it what? Babel. Babbling. Yeah. That's what we call it. We call it babbling, be based upon this, all right? Go ahead, Freedom.
This dispersion signifies a transition to the next dispensation that focuses on God's covenant with Abraham and his descendants, setting the stage for a more individualized relationship with God.
Okay. So we're going to the next one. What's the next one? Keep going. Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead. Go ahead. We're still in government. Go ahead.
The principle of human governance under divine direction is reinforced in the New Testament, particularly in Paul's epistle to the Romans. In Romans 13, 1 through 7, Paul explains that all governing authorities are instituted by God to suppress chaos and foster societal order.
Well, we know that ain't happened. Go ahead.
Romans 13, 1 states, "Let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established."
So he goes back to what we read in Daniel and basically repeats it. God, the word of God interprets itself. So if you don't believe what was said in Daniel, now you got it in Romans. Same thing. There's nobody getting government in authority that God did not place there. Now, it has nothing to do with how good they are. Okay? We just know the purpose is to drive us to God, no matter who they are. All right, go ahead.
This reinforces the idea of governing bodies as an extension of God's ordained order, tasked with upholding justice and societal welfare.
Mm-hmm.
We skip the complementary sources. The next is the thought-provoking question.
Okay, so think about this. It didn't say nothing about our government supposed to be our savior. Yeah, our government ain't supposed to be our savior. And your celebrities ain't supposed to, not, your celebrities do not supposed to be your conscience. Okay? I've said this 1,000 times. Don't let your entertainers, your athletes, your comedians, the basically the court jesters of this world be your moral compass. They have one purpose, to entertain you. You should not be telling me what Steve Harvey say. I don't care what Steve Harvey say. He's there to make me go. That's his purpose. That's what he get paid to do. Okay? But now what we've done is, and you can see it again, I got to use the past election. All these stars come out on both sides. And you think about it. They believe they got control of you.
Yeah, they use a platform.
Right.
Yeah.
Doors. Right. Doors.
Other people.
Taylor Swift, they bring them out because Taylor Swift has a strong following.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. And you think if she, all she got to do is say, vote for this person, and you so blinded that you're going to vote for this person. Same thing on the other side. They bought out the different people that were stars that they consider stars to tell you, Hulk Hogan, to tell you, vote for her. You know. You know. But you got to be real with yourself. How many of y'all get sucked up into stuff like that? That y'all got y'all favorite person, like even an Oprah, that you gonna listen to and take your moral compass from? Okay, but I mean, haven't we all had somebody, now come on now, come on now. Have we all had somebody that was in that position?
Televangelist,
there it is. Yeah, you can't imagine how many, well, they don't do that no more because they know my response, but you can't remember, people come to me, what, did you hear what Jake said? I don't care what Jake say. Did you hear what Kiwan said? I don't care what Kiwan say. I don't care what these people say. Why? Because I got a Bible to listen to what God say. And unless they saying what matches up with God's word, if I know they twisting God's word, I don't need to keep listening. If once I know you a twister, I ain't got to listen to you no more. Once I know I can catch you twisting, and again, even a broken clock is right twice a day. So they're not obvious, but again, you have to take it with the way you want to take it. I have no celebrity. You shouldn't even want to follow a celebrity, Pastor. Because it's normally the celebrityism that takes them over into the flesh.
Yes. Right.
Okay? And it's hard for them. I'm not saying that they start off wrong, but it's something about us. We love fame. People. We love being important. Okay? So it's hard. And again, the Bible even says it's your fault that they like that. You know why? Because the Bible says in this day, what's going to happen, brother? What we going to do? What the Bible say we going to do? As far as our teachers and pastors. There you go. So God say, that's y'all fault. Because if they didn't have a following, would they stop?
Yeah.
Okay?
Demigods.
Yeah, they demigods. Okay, go ahead, Frieda.
Thought-provoking question.
Mm-hmm.
Considering the foundational principles of justice and governance established during the dispensation of government, how can contemporary societies integrate these divine guidelines with the pluralistic and diverse ethical framework of the modern world,
so,
ensuring both equity and adherence to the underlying moral tenets?
So in other words, how can we as Christians, I'm going to do the simple thing. When I'm writing, I do the scholarly thing, but I want to make it simple. How can we in this society of pluralism, okay, which means it's, you know, it's a little bit everybody, okay? How can we stay focused on what God say when so much is pulling against us to go with what culture say and what the government say? And when we're told to obey the government, I know I just threw out a lot there, but think about it. Is there any time that we should not obey the government?
If it goes outside of the word of God,
right. Mm-hmm. If it goes
outside
of the word, go ahead.
There's going to come a time that way. It's going to come. We're getting to that point where it's coming a time where we're going to have to stand on what God says against what society says.
Okay.
We're coming to that point. We are spoiled in Western culture, mm-hmm. but we're coming to that point where we're going to really understand what it means to stand for God.
Okay, good. And again, I'm not going to, you know, let's be honest. We don't know what that looks like.
Mm-hmm.
So to sit here in my arrogance and say, hey, I'm not going to shrink back. Mm-hmm. That'd be a lie to you. I don't know.
We don't know. Right.
And even if you do, don't mean that you're not saved.
Amen.
That means that you're scared.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
And our example is.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Peter.
Mm-hmm.
He walked with Jesus. Jesus talked
everything.
To him. Everything, you know? Mm-hmm. And when it came time when Jesus told him, you're going to deny me three times. And he was like, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm for you all the way. But when it came time when Jesus was being to be executed, Peter shied away.
I don't know who that is.
Hold up. When they came and arrested Jesus, they all ran.
Yeah, they all ran.
You know what I'm saying? Think about it. I'm going to follow. As soon as them torches came up the road, they was like, deuces. John followed from a distance. Peter followed from a distance. But they followed far enough back.
Yeah, where they couldn't get caught up.
Where they couldn't get caught up. Okay? But again, don't just. And see, this is the beauty of the apostles. It shows so much humanism. Like we would be. I would be terrified. Okay? I don't know what I would do. I hope I would say I live and die for the Lord. But maybe I won't. But it does not take away my salvation. Salvation does not require bravery or martyrdom. You almost got to be called to that level of relationship that you're saying, okay, I'm just going to deny Jesus. Because Jesus, some people had to live to carry on the gospel.
Right.
Okay? And you see, from the bravery of those who would die in Christ, martyred in Christ, all the apostles, all of them, the prophets, all of them, that encourages us that when that day comes, like Alicia said, that maybe it will spring forth just enough bravery to say, I'm going to stand for the Lord. You do what you do.
Right. But what I liked about that's not the end part of that, is that when you could see Peter's guilty conscience about that.
Mm-hmm.
And when Jesus came back on the scene from being resurrected, he called for Peter. Mm-hmm. So you see the compassion that Jesus still has for the man that denied him, that he knew was going to happen, and that he brought him back into the fold. Like, you're not lost like Judas was. Come back to me. And I love that part about
Jesus restored him the right relationship. And upon restoring him, he recommissioned him to do the assignment.
Exactly.
And he was better after the failure
than
he was before the failure. He was Peter with the foot-shaped mouth before. And then he becomes Peter, this apostle, that stands up to the Jews. It says, for the Gentile church, our forefathers could not keep the commandments. Why should we put this on the Jews? On the Gentile church. So sometimes where failure is not fatal if you keep and stay in the game. That's what I see out of it. You may fail now, but get back up. Stay in the game. You might have to go through a chastisement period or a period of feeling the loneliness of the separation from the fellowship of the saints or the fellowship of God. But realize if you save, it's temporary. Did you learn the lessons of being separated? Obviously, we know Peter did, but Jesus gave one last test. He said, Peter, do you love me?
Yeah.
And Peter said, of course I do, Lord. And he gave Peter his commission, feed my sheep. Then asked him again, Peter, do you really love me? Not only feed my sheep, feed my lambs. Okay, then he asked him a third time. And then Peter got kind of frustrated saying, God, you know I love you. And he said, okay, then feed my people. Feed my people. That's all you got to do. And as we think about it, we got a lot of churches doing everything else but that. Where their concentration may be that a little bit, but, you know, we want to build stuff. We want to build monuments, you know. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing. It's only a bad thing if we don't keep the first things first. That's only become, if we could become, if our whole thing is we say, come to our church and look at our campus. Okay, look how nice our campus is.
Yeah.
Well, again, that doesn't say the quality of the teaching. That's just say somebody's smart in real estate and financing and know how to do that, get that done. And again, I'm saying there's nothing wrong with that. But pastors and preachers are called to one assignment and one assignment only. And me being as simple as I am and as concerned as I am, I don't see how you can do all the other ones. Not effectively if you're doing this effectively, because this takes up too much time. You know?
So when they elevate that above God, because the monuments or the buildings in and of itself is not bad, but when it gets elevated above God's word, or God's self and the purpose, then that's when it's
because they want to say the building is holy. And there's no building in town that's holy. It's the people. God is indwelling in the people. That we're the building that's not made by hands. And when we come into any space, God is coming into space with us. And that makes the space sacred. But the space, when we leave up out of here, there's no sacred in this place. There's nothing floating around in this place. You know. Yeah, other than lint and dust, which we got plenty of. All right. Go ahead, Steph.
When you talk about obeying government, it reminds me of Coco Gauff. Like when she won the U.S. Open, she was like, I just want to thank my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But then when she was over in Saudi Arabia, she obeyed that government. She didn't say anything about Jesus. She said, I want to thank the man above. Because over there, you cannot mention Jesus. Mm. So, yeah.
Yeah. So she had a chance to shake it all up, but she knew better. And sometimes you got to use wisdom.
Yeah.
She understood she couldn't say that. Yeah. And she lucky that she could. Was she covered in her face and stuff? No. She's lucky she didn't have her covered up talking. So, I mean, yeah, we have to live beyond that. Okay, Stacey, go ahead.
Dispensation of promise.
Mm-hmm. We're gonna stop right there, cause I don't want to go into promise, cause promise is gonna start the whole thing with Abraham. Okay. But if you notice, all these dispensations that we've been into up to this point, they're all in the Old Testament. Okay. This is just a flyby over what I've studied, and you got the resources to which I pulled this stuff from. So this is actually a new lesson, but it's an old lesson, because I have a much thicker lesson on these dispensations, okay? But this is just, I think this was the pertinent part of it. So it gets you to see how God was dealing with mankind. That's all dispensation means. How we see God is dealing with mankind as we're heading towards Jesus, okay? As we're heading towards Jesus. And now we're getting to get into the fun part, the dispensation of promise, okay? The dispensation of promise, all right? So, does anybody have any questions or want to add or throw something out that we can talk about for about 5 minutes? Anybody? Anybody got any questions?
So, when you say that the dispensation of government, you said that's when God introduced capital punishment?
Mm-hmm.
Because of the Noah flood?
Is that what? No, he introduced capital punishment when he said that when a person kills another person, they get to put them to death.
Okay.
Cause they adjudicate. See, when that word adjudicate means they will convene to judge somebody. Okay. So that's a form of government. Like our government now, we have three branches. We have one branch that adjudicates everything. Okay. We have another branch that creates the law. So what at this time he's saying, the law is if a man takes another man's life, then that life is old. Now, this has been going on, Venus, if I'm not correct, this continued into the Old Testament for a long time.
Yeah, right.
Okay? We're going to see that in the Mosaic Law. That, and see, what I'm saying is this stuff, some things didn't stop. Some things just continued and got more defined. So by the time we get to the Mosaic Covenants, you see what you adjudicate. You see the election of judges. So as we move down in history, you see more of this governing thing going on that doesn't stop.
And then you also get the safe havens.
Yes.
And you give reasons why, not excuses, but exceptions to why death wouldn't happen if you killed the other person.
Right.
Yes. So, okay.
Remember, we learned that in
right. Sanctuary cities.
Yeah, that's what we did, sanctuary cities.
Yes.
Yeah.
So the dispensation of government, like, it really didn't stop?
No, okay. It's still going on today.
Okay. I mean, that's okay. I mean, I guess when it said the end, I was like, why are you still?
What it doesn't mean like the end as you think of it. What it means like now we're moving into another area where God is more focused on the next thing.
Okay.
It's progressive.
Okay.
So it doesn't necessarily end. It's just only thing that ended was innocence. Everything else is building.
Yeah. Yes. Okay.
Because the New Testament epistles talk about a seared conscience. The New Testament talks about government. As we saw, you know, it talks about government. So we get progression towards Jesus, all right? And like she said, like y'all in the study, At some point in God's dealing with people, the law said if you you could accidentally murder somebody, and if you can get to a sanctuary city and stay there, yeah, you don't have to worry about this judgment. This coming down on you, okay?
Yeah, so certain rules that they have to follow when they can go, where they can accept it. I think we talked about that.
Yeah.
Mostly when we were in Kings, when we were First and Second Kings and First and Second Chronicles, we talked about those sanctuary cities.
And see, that's how we know. See, the fact that you can remember that lets you know that the Bible getting smaller to you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You might not know the exact passage, but you know where the idea is. Okay? And that's what I mean by the Bible getting smaller to you. That's why this is important, because if you can understand a little bit of this, you can say, oh, that was during the dispensation of promise, or that was during the dispensation of innocence. And you already know, go to Genesis for the first five. Okay? And then we move into grace and the church and all of that stuff. Okay? So that's the lesson for today. I don't know if everybody has this book, but I think Nancy, you don't have it. Michelle, you don't have it. So here's two books. Go ahead, Miriam.
Under the dispensation of government.
Uh-huh.
Second paragraph, the first sentence, when it says this dispensation begins with the renewal of God's covenant, mm-hmm, with Noah after the flood. So I was looking back in Genesis to see the exact wording. Maybe what was the first covenant? Whether he had to renew, but you said he had to let them live in order to live out the covenant. So what was the covenant that he had to renew?
It said to repopulate the world.
To repopulate the world.
Yeah, to repopulate the world.
So when it said be fruitful and multiply.
That's repopulating the world.
Right. So that, okay, he said that several times. That's why once it was like.
Well, he only told you to be fruitful and multiply. In this context, after the flood, because he wouldn't have to tell them to be fruitful and multiply any other time.
He said it to Adam and Eve.
Right, because it was only two. Right. So now you got the two, and now you got the eight.
And then,
the other times, he wouldn't have had to say that because they were already multiplying and doing all the stuff they should be doing.
Right, they had already multiplied enough in the world. You have to remember, these dispensations may be hundreds and hundreds of years apart. So it's not like 10 years here, 15 years here. No, there might be 200, 300 years between each dispensation. We don't know how long Adam walked in the innocence of God.
Right.
It could have been millenniums. Okay? So obviously the world was populated because he destroyed it. The world was full of, okay, go back to when everything was created. He created one, he created two, male and female. They started having, so obviously the world was populated with animals, creeping things, and human beings. Okay? And they were and not the things, but the humankind that was called, were chosen to monitor them, but became evil, became a fight between nature and humanity, became evil. So God say, look, I got to stop this, but I got to keep the covenant of what I promised Eve. I can't destroy everybody. So he sovereignly chooses Noah and his eight sons. And he said, build this ark in the middle of the desert where there's never. Now, think about this, Mary, you might not know this. There was no such thing as rain. They didn't know what rain was. He said, build the ark, it's going to rain. He like, rain?
No, so I knew that. So the promise to Eve was the seed, the mm-hmm. enmity between her seed. That's how they had to be fruitful and multiply.
They had to. He had to keep the human in existence. There can't be a Jesus if everybody died, right? What I'm saying is, if he'd have wiped out everybody on Earth with the flood, how do you get humans? He'd have to start all over again,
right,
with dust and dirt.
So the promise that he made to Eve, he had to keep through that. And the promise itself was the repopulating of the earth?
No, the promise was that the Savior would come through humankind, which she's the... Eve is considered the mother of all creation.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
So the seed of salvation was going to come through her.
And she... Okay, and he would not be able to put enmity between them had she not had more because it would have just been just them. Is that what I'm not saying?
I'm trying to filter what you just said.
Okay, because you're saying the enmity, well, in the word, when he tells her what he's going to do, and you're saying the promise that he made to her.
Who's the enmity between?
Between her seed and Satan.
Okay.
So if she did not have.
So enmity, another word for enmity is enemies.
Right.
Okay? They're enemies. And he's saying that rivalry, that enemy, what's going to happen is your seed, which she don't, she, and again, when God would say that to people in their time, guess what they thought? It was going to happen in their time.
Exactly, because they was going to make it where they hated him and he hated them. There was going to be confusion between them.
You got to remember, Jesus is God. There was already confusion when they disobeyed God. When they disobeyed God, they disobeyed Jesus. So there was already enmity between man and God and Satan and God. Enmity between Satan and God started when he kicked them out of the kingdom, kicked them out of heaven, when they threw them down to the earth. So the enmity between Satan and God had already took place. The enmity between man and God hadn't taken place until Satan tricked them. And then at that point, now man is God's enemy, and so is Satan. But God, through his grace and his mercy, saying, I'm going to deliver man, and you're going to have a child that's going to be the Savior that fixes things. And it's going to come through the womb of a woman, which is Eve, because she's the mother of all humans. But most people, when God would prophesy about something, they would think that it's going to happen in their lifetime. Not understanding God is not governed by linear time. Because the Bible says one day in God's kingdom is like how many years?
1,000 years.
And 1,000 years is like a day.
One day.
So God, think about this. 1,000 years to us is one day for God.
Right. And vice versa.
And vice versa. So God will say something because he's eternal. And when we put it in linear time, of course, God gonna bless us now. He gonna fix it now.
Right.
But God may not fix. God may make a promise to you that you'll never see.
Right.
But your children's children's children will see.
We'll see.
And God will say, that's as good as giving it to you. Because
yeah.
I was faithful and I told you that your seed or somebody in your family would do X, Y, and Z. And you thought it was going to be somebody that you knew.
Right.
And it's your great, 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 great grandchild that end up fulfilling the promise that God.
Thank you for tuning in to the Walk in Truth Christian Fellowship Church broadcast on the WITRN network. Come join us every Sunday at 9 a.m. Central Standard Time for Sunday worship. Bible study is held on Tuesdays at 11 a.m. and 7 p.m. Central Standard Time. We are located at 3006 North Lindbergh Boulevard, Suite 711, St. Louis, Missouri, 63074. All are welcome, and we look forward to seeing you soon.